We're asked to find the formula for each sequence, which is either arithmetic or geometric. If the sequence is arithmetic, then the pattern defined successive terms in the sequence is to add a constant, which means successive terms have a common difference, d, which is equal to a sub n minus a sub n minus 1. And if it is arithmetic, then the formula for the sequence will be a sub n equals a sub 1 plus the quantity n minus 1 times d. But if the sequence is geometric, then the pattern defined successive terms is to multiply by a constant, meaning successive terms have a common ratio r, which is equal to a sub n divided by a sub n minus 1. And if it's geometric, the sequence formula is a sub n equals a sub 1 times r raised to the power of n minus 1. So the first step is to determine whether we have an arithmetic or geometric sequence. And these two are a little more challenging because the terms are fractions. Looking at this first sequence, if we think that it might be arithmetic, it's a good idea to write all the terms as fractions with a common denominator. And we can think of 1 as 1 over 1. So notice how our common denominator would be 6. So we can rewrite this sequence as 6 over 6. We'd multiply 4 thirds by 2 over 2. 4 times 2 is 8. And 3 times 2 is 6. We'd multiply 3 halves by 3 over 3, which would give us 9 sixths. Notice when the sequence is written like this, it's much easier to see that the terms are increasing by 1/6 each time. 6/6 plus 1/6 is 7/6. 7/6 plus 1/6 is 8/6. And 8/6 plus 1/6 is 9/6. So because we're adding a constant each time, this means we have an arithmetic sequence with a common difference equal to 1/6. Of course, if we wanted to, we could use the formula for d and the formula for r to see whether we have a common difference or common ratio. To determine d, we would pick any term in the sequence, a sub n, and subtract a sub n minus 1, which would be the term before a sub n. So looking at the sequence again in this form, notice that 7/6 minus 6/6 is 1/6, 8/6 minus 7/6 is 1/6, and so on. But if we tried to find the common ratio, it would not be the same for successive terms. For example, notice that if we did 7/6 divided by 1, that would be 7/6. So we might think r is going to be equal to 7/6. But if we take 4 thirds and divide by 7/6, this would be the same as 4 thirds times the reciprocal, or 6 sevenths. So I can simplify here. That's 1, that's 2. Notice how using these two terms, we would have r equal to 8 sevenths, which obviously doesn't equal 7/6, verifying the sequence is not geometric. So now that we know that it's arithmetic and we have d, notice we also have to find a sub 1, the first term, which is equal to 1, which means the formula for our sequence, a sub n, is equal to a sub 1, which is 1, plus n minus 1 times the common difference d, which is 1/6. We'll go ahead and clear the parentheses here. So we'll have a sub n equals 1 plus, we'll distribute here, we'll have 1/6 n minus 1/6. Well, 1 minus 1/6 would be 6/6 minus 1/6, or 5/6. So we can write this as a sub n equals 1/6 n plus 5/6. Or if we wanted to, we could actually factor out 1/6 and write our formula as a sub n equals 1/6 times the quantity n minus 5. Either of these last two forms would be acceptable. These two formulas would allow us to find any term in the given sequence. Now let's go ahead and take a look at our second example. Notice how if we did want to obtain a common denominator, it would have to be 125. But if we think the sequence may be geometric, it's often helpful to look at the numerator and denominator separately. So let's go ahead and write 4 as 4 over 1. We'll leave the other fractions the same. And now again, if we take a look at the numerator and denominator separately, Looking at the numerator, we have 4, 8, 16, 32. Notice the pattern for the numerators is that we're multiplying by 2 each time. And then for the denominator, we have 1, 5, 25, 125. So we're actually multiplying by 5 each time in the denominator. So if we're multiplying the numerator by 2 and the denominator by 5 each time, that means r, the common ratio, would be 2/5, because we're multiplying by 2/5 each time to find the next fraction. So when dealing with fractions, you want to be able to analyze the sequence and make a prediction as to whether it is arithmetic or geometric, because it can save some time. Of course, the other way again is to rely on the formulas for d and r. Let's go ahead and just show that. If we test for a common ratio r, again, we take any term a sub n and divide by the previous term a sub n minus 1. But notice that if we had 8/5 and divided by 4, well, instead of dividing by 4 over 1, let's multiply by the reciprocal, 1/4. If we simplify this, there's 1 4 and 4 and 2 4s and 8. Notice how r is equal to 2/5. This alone doesn't tell us that it's geometric. We'd also want to test two other consecutive terms. Let's go ahead and test 16/25 divided by 8/5. 16/25, instead of dividing, we'll multiply by the reciprocal. So we'll multiply by 5/8. Simplify. And notice again, r is 2/5, which confirms we do have a geometric sequence. If we try to test for an arithmetic sequence, the common difference d would not be the same between pairs of successive terms. For example, if we tried to find the common difference d using the first two terms, we'd have 8/5 minus 4, where 4 is equal to 20/5. This would be what, negative 12/5. If we try to find d using the third and second terms, it's not going to be negative 12/5. We would have d equals 16/25 minus 8/5, which we'd multiply by 5 over 5 to obtain a common denominator, so that'd be minus 40/25. This would be what, negative 24/25, which is not equal to negative 12/5, verifying this is not arithmetic. So now that we know that it's geometric, and we know r is equal to 2/5, and a sub 1, the first term, is equal to 4, we know our formula for the sequence a sub n is equal to a sub 1, which is 4, times r, which is 2/5, raised to the power of n minus 1. Again, this formula allows us to find any term in the geometric sequence. So as you can see, if we recognize the pattern, it can save quite a bit of time. If we don't, we have to rely on calculating d and r for several pairs of successive terms. I hope you found this explanation helpful.